My name is Andrew McMeekin. I'm a photographer and I live in Lowestoft, Suffolk. I'd love to take you all out to tea with me. It's a bit of a journey from Lowestoft to Bangladesh and back, but this tea started to brew in the mid-1800s, so I know it'll be worth it. My story starts with an end. In 2014, my mother, Lorna, sadly passed away at the grand old age of 97.
Whilst going through her papers, I stopped again and again to read those she kept close to her heart in her little brown handbag. Certificates and snippets of the family history made fascinating reading, especially those about the pioneer tea planter, my great-grandfather, Thomas McMeekin. I knew we were a family with tea in its blood, and the documents I read brought even more memories back to life again. Various members of the family have carried out research into the whole family's tea connections over the years. My cousin Margaret has specialised in our branch of the family, exploring Thomas McMeekin's and our grandfather Matthew's lives.
What an absolutely marvellous day to go sailing on the Broads. Here at Oulton Broad, this is the river frontage from the Sillett Bungalow, where my grandfather, Matthew McMeekin, first came to and built when he returned from India. We're so grateful to the present owners for kindly allowing us to come back to Matthew's bungalow to film here. I can well remember the aura of India here in Oulton Broad, so let's go and have a closer look. The typical Indian style of some of the windows, as we can see here, and much of the furniture in the bungalow have been brought back from the tea gardens. Being here in front of the original Inglenook fireplace brings back childhood memories of visiting my grandfather along with Father Sid and my brother Bruce. I first got my taste of India then. The bungalow is originally called Sillett after the area in Assam where the gardens had been. Were they still there, I asked myself. What would they be like now? I decided to find out about my great-grandfather Thomas McMeekin's fascinating tea times. And armed with Margaret's invaluable research as background, I took up the challenge. So if you're ready, I'll put the kettle on and we'll go and find the tea.
My team has researched extensively to plan our trip. I take time to drop in to see Margaret, our family's researcher, for one last chat about our great-grandfather before leaving.
Well, he was born in 1834 in Dumbartonshire, and he went on to be a gardener in the Lugal area, and his father was at some time a gardener at Kew and managed to secure a place for him. So he went to Kew, and from there he went to India. Well, I think lots of the gardeners from Kew were going to India, and that was the reason that took his fancy, and he thought he'd have a try. Because, of course, there was lots of money to be made out there at that time.
Well, there was a lot of money sloshing around these days.
Yes.
I think he first went into partnership with Colonel Noonan.
Yeah, that was a disaster, really, because he went into partnership with Mooney, and then Mooney was in Calcutta and he was based at the tea gardens. But he sent all the money to Mooney, but he squandered it at the racecourse in Calcutta. Well, he returned in 1864 to get married. Then he went back again with his wife, and three children were born in Kashgar. And then, of course, he came home at various intervals.
We're off. After all the planning and research, we're heading for Bangladesh, hopefully to see some of the tea gardens which Thomas McMeekin set up and owned. In Dhaka, we'll meet Mr. Asan, the managing director of the National Tea Company of Bangladesh. The National Tea Company now owns many of the tea gardens established by my great-grandfather, and Mr. Asan kindly offered his support with the project. We plunge headlong into the vibrancy of Dhaka street life. I'm now introduced to real traffic with all its tut-tuts, rickshaws and noise. Amazingly, there are seldom accidents as they all weave in and out of each other, with only inches to spare. Pedestrians dash skillfully amongst the chaos. Tea has an important role in Dhaka's daily life. The hundreds of small tea stalls are social hubs, buzzing with people dropping in. A quick cuppa, often laced with condensed milk, is drunk, and gossip exchanged whilst tea is brewed non-stop. The tea stall we visit also supplies the rickshaw repair yard next door. A couple of days acclimatising in Dhaka gives us a chance to visit an important landmark.
Here we are in Dhaka after going through the streets of mayhem and Stritti Shaw Monument, which is behind my shoulder here, which is one of the national monuments of Dhaka. We've gathered quite a crowd here, which shows how enthusiastic everybody is. So what now we'll do is go down, then we'll show you the monument.
We pack our equipment and leave for Sylhet, where the tea gardens are clustered. Although the very bumpy 5-hour trip is challenging, Mr. Asan has thoughtfully arranged for us to stop off en route at the Chandi Chura Tea Garden. We enjoy an excellent lunch hosted by the charming Mr. Abdul Awal, the Deputy General Manager, in his splendid bungalow. After lunch, we are joined by Mrs. Awal and go to see the Luskapur Valley Club, which is like stepping back in time. We're setting off again. We're driving through tea as far as the eye can see now. Let me tell you a bit about Thomas's beginnings in tea and his connections to other companies. I learnt from Margaret that in 1869 they moved to Sylhet. Thomas then offered his services to Finlay's, a leading company in the tea world. And allegedly, Sir John Muir gave him sole charge of the tea department in Calcutta in 1880. This arrangement lasted until 1885, Thomas devoting his energy to his tea gardens and taking over the Chandipur estate as well. He then diversified into marketing his own products in the UK, launching his company McMeekin & Co. with a partner, Peter MacDonald, at 19 Wellington Street, Glasgow. It is believed that Sir John Muir, who recognised his ability, provided the finance for setting up of McMeekin & Co. in London, tea valuers and tasters. At the end of 1910, Duncan Brothers acquired a controlling interest in the Ali Nugger Company, and Patrakula, Korma and Madripoor Gardens, known as the Trio Estates from the McMeekin family. Amongst many others, Thomas McMeekin's Trio Estates are now owned by the National Tea Company. We finally arrive at our base, Patrakula Tea Garden. We are enormously privileged to be able to stay in the Patrakula manager's bungalow. Mr. Shahjahan, the general manager, and the manager Celine enthusiastically assist us where they can with our project. The staff look after our every need, which involves drinking lots of cups of lovely tea. I can easily imagine Thomas sitting here enjoying a cup of his tea. Little has changed in the bungalow and its English-style garden, which is Mr. Shahjahan's pride and joy. He patrols his flower and vegetable gardens daily and knows every banana personally. Unfortunately, his star dahlias are in daily danger of being snapped by the goats and dogs that get in and charge around his garden. During our stay, I often get up very early to go and film as the early morning mist slowly evaporates. It's a magical time of day in the tea gardens. The tea garden has many changing aspects throughout the year, from the vibrant green, lush, ready-to-pick leaves right through to the drier pruning season. The roaming cows and buffaloes provide nature's best fertiliser. There is a huge amount of work to be done in each season of tea, such as seedling planting, pest control through to plucking, to ensure a crop of top quality tea. The shade of trees which diffuse the sun are vital to protect the tea bushes. Back at the bungalow, work is going on too. The wood for the hot water and kitchen is being chopped. It seems to be fish on the menu tonight. Ismail, the National Tea Company star cook, does sterling work rustling up a range of goodies, starting with pre-dinner snacks such as pakora, served on the terrace. His dessert highlight is the very British caramel cream. In his 80s now, Ismail has been in the company service since he was a young boy, when he learnt some of his recipes from the British. After an early morning film session, breakfast is the star meal, with omelettes, fried eggs, excellent roti, toast and jam. Of course, tea flows constantly all day. My great-grandfather, Thomas McMeekin, a tea garden pioneer in the late 1800s, was a proud owner of Patrakula, Alinugger, Korma and Matrapore gardens in the Slet area of Bangladesh. Patrakula is the hub of the garden wheel with over 4,500 acres and a workforce of thousands. The owners, the National Tea Company, provide a hospital, primary school and healthcare for the labourers and their families. The energetic drumming you can hear in the background is part of the preparations for the next week's festival. Patrakula's manager Salim lives at the traditional Burra bungalow. The terraces of the bungalows are delightful places to sit and talk tea. Salim's working days are packed full with everything that is involved in running a tea garden and organising its huge workforce. He still manages to squeeze in time to show us around. We are all prepped and ready for an early morning start, and the entire team and equipment is squashed into the back of Salim's Jeep. The vast expanse of the tea garden is separated into divisions which all have to be visited and checked on. The giant tea garden is run with precision. The third stage of pruning takes place in the winter months. It's amazing to think that all these areas have to be visited by an unseen workforce. In the mystical vapours of the early morning, I can only think this really is a peaceful place. Today, Mr. Shah Jahan has brought us to Matrapore Tea Garden, which is one of the renowned trio estates run by Thomas. Matrapore is absolutely huge, with its rolling hills and lakes. It's a stunning beauty spot, which the general public are allowed to visit. This is yet another aspect of tea. Mr. Shah Jahan tells me the lakes are perfect to enhance the humidity of the air, improving the health of the tea bushes. The pioneer tea planters were truly an amazing breed, who could transform dense vegetation into uniform rows of tea bushes, which delivered substantial, high-quality crops. The abundant bird life is testimony to the clean air, and the views are a photographer's paradise. This is a rare shot of Jackie, who's our driver, bodyguard, translator, as well as an assistant cameraman. With no time to waste, we are torn out of relaxation mode and move on to Matrapore factory. It's far too loud in here for me to talk through all the stages of tea processing. The tea aficionados amongst you certainly won't need my commentary. The factory manager Roy gives us a whistle-stop tour of the production processes in Matrapore. Clambering over the wooden walkways above the conveyor belts, passing giant hoppers, We gaze into the fiery mouth of the drying drum and move on to the grading machine.
And here we are at the final stage of the tea process, and this is the sizing machine, which sizes the tea particles into small, medium and large, and other grades as well. But here we are having the tea and the tea tasting area, which is tested every 3 hours throughout the day to maintain that the tea is at top quality. These are experts in the field and they're very proud of what they produce.
Now we've had our initiation into the nitty gritty of tea processing. Our heads are spinning with tea facts. We recover from the hectic factory tour at the impressive Korma bungalow. Korma is the third of the trio estates. What a traditional place this is, another building in the British colonial style. The basic structure of the building has probably hardly changed since it was built. The open plan terrace is the place of choice for both meetings and relaxation. Most of the bungalows have their own fruit and vegetable gardens. So much for the present-day British understanding of the term bungalow. Following yesterday's initiation into the tea production process, we now all go on for a more official tour of Korma Tea Factory. Mr. Asan takes time out to accompany us. We start in the manager's office and see the original safe and rolls of honour of past managers. Unfortunately, all older documents were lost in war damage. Most interesting is the old desk and manager's chair where my great-grandfather probably sat. The large jars of white termite queens in formaldehyde, labelled according to year, are pointed out to us. The factory is very well run. During our tour, all of us men get weighed on the industrial scales and are declared fit for auction weight-wise. The sharpening machines for the rollers are in frequent use. I daren't lean in too closely. Thomas was much more than a planter. He also invented and improved machinery for various tea processors. As this area was then India, his patents are listed as patents of invention for British India. I've seen a lot of people working with tea now, but this is only a fraction of the workforce. So where and how do the others live? As I mentioned before, Patrakula has a hospital with trained first aiders, a school, and health workers visit too.
Brake health program, sorry, Brake health program.
Health program.
Yeah.
Oh, very good. You.
Health worker.
Well done.
I go off to see where everyone lives, so it's down to see more of the everyday life of the village now. Our cameraman Gilnay has gone ahead to see if it's okay for us to film in the village.
It's okay, they said we can go in.
Here we are inside the workers' accommodation blocks. These are fabulous little bungalows, which are very clean and tidy, concrete construction, and the workers look very happy within.
Of course, our cameras seem fun and are fascinating. Well, some people are surprised to see us. But everyone is very welcoming. It's a hive of industry here, especially as the festival is nearing. The river is vital for all sorts of everyday activities. It's wash day today. I follow my nose now over to the catering section to see how the preparations for the festival are coming along. Relays of people are cooking up a storm here, and to judge by the size of the cooking pots, they're expecting quite a few for dinner. Dignitaries are gathering and things are hotting up for the party. We're very honoured to have been invited along. There are local community leaders, offerings and highly energetic musicians and dancers. The world, and especially its wife, is here to celebrate the new statue and shrine to the goddess Shiva. The evening ends with us being warmly welcomed to the dignitary's marquee. As we leave the party, it's still in full swing and it goes on for a couple of days. Today, the team and I are on the way to one of the many British cemeteries. We take the back route to Srimangol and have a light-hearted moment en route as we stop to film a family of spectacled monkeys whooping and swinging through the trees. In the time when the jungle was being cleared to create tea gardens, it wasn't only wild animals as harmless as these that the pioneer tea planters were confronted with. Elephants, tigers, jackals and other wild animals abounded. The original planters were certainly a determined and hardened bunch. British cemeteries are testament to the huge human cost of life establishing and living in the tea gardens. It's tragic to see many people died at such a very young age. Malaria, the notorious Blackwater fever, other diseases, and the searing heat all took their toll. And let's not forget the wives. We are reminded here that as well as the Spartan trials of everyday life, childbirth was fatal for many and infant mortality was high. My own great-grandmother gave birth to three children in Kachar. The tea gardens resulting from the hardships endured have maintained the structure set up all those years ago. The nursery plays a key role in the garden management and is run like a military manoeuvre. Armies of seedlings are nurtured along. Battalions of saplings are grown, and strategies to increase disease resistance are set out. There is an immense amount of work and thought behind every robust tea bush. Without the nimble fingers of the nursery teams, healthy crops would be very hit and miss. The flourishing, carefully tended nurseries ensure the future for tea here. The area Thomas worked in was in those days India. He was not restricted by borders between Sachar, Kachar and Sylhet. We travel across the bridge spanning the river he would have used for transport and go as far as the Indian border. On the way back we pass the Ali Nugger Tea Garden, now owned by Duncan Brothers, which had been another of Thomas's gardens. A cup of tea at sunset is drunk with the National Tea Company managers at the last tea stall before the border. With borders on my mind, I'm at the beautiful Champarai Tea Garden. Here we are standing in Bangladesh. As you see behind me, the river This is the borders into India, and we're now going to cross the little bridge to stand on the Indian side. To remind us of the change from India to Bangladesh, Salim, the manager of Patrakula, takes us to the Liberation Monument, where a local historian explains the history of the spot. We can see the border from the lookout tower, where the commander of the border patrol invites us for tea.
Now you stand here, you can see that area now divided into two countries. But your forefather, when he came here, it was
one country.
One country. Mm. Now you are following his footsteps.
Yeah. A very bright man.
Of course. Yeah,
of course.
He's a great man who came across this area and founded this big gardens, yeah. Big tea estates.
All around this.
All around this area. So you are following his footsteps.
We're setting up to film the ladies in their colourful saris amongst the tea bushes. As I less elegantly clamber about amongst the rows, I realise now how steep the terrain is too. I note how strong and sharp the branches and twigs are. My translator and lighting man Jackie is in the thick of it with me. The scene of the ladies from Patrakula Tea Gardens plucking the tea leaves in the afternoon sun is a wonderful sight. Tea gardens, tranquility. We gather the plucking team for a group photo. Kamal, our locations manager, hands over a token of our appreciation, which is very well received. My trip to discover more about Thomas McMeekin's tea times is nearing an end. The team and I will be sad to leave Bangladesh and all the people we've met. We can't thank the National Tea Company enough for their help whilst filming. We are very touched when all the local managers arrive to bid us farewell, bearing in mind that the drive here would have taken some of them an hour or so.
So we're back in England now. I'm standing at the Spurgeon's College, South Norwood Hill, overlooking Central and South London. Spurgeon's College is home to an international student learning community studying theology. In 1922, Mr. Charles Hay Walker gave this property and some of the surrounding land in trust to the college. This was fulfilling the wish of his late wife, who had died in 1918. To endow part of a considerable fortune to the Baptist cause. Built in the 1890s, this imposing mansion was known originally as Falkland Park. So what connects this story to my great-grandfather's tea times? Let me unravel the tale. It's hard to believe that I'm standing here in Falkland Park House, walking down the staircase which my great-grandfather built back in the 1890s. So it was really quite a legacy to the tea which he produced and imported. When Thomas returned to England, he bought this land from the 12th Earl of Falkland. The house and the land were sold to him in 1889 for £37,000, which was a vast amount of money in those days. He moved into the sizeable Grangehurst house together with his servants and decided to have a new grand residence built. He called the new mansion Falkland Park. The architect was Henry Adair Rowlands, and the house was built by Patman and Fotheringham of Theobalds Road, London. The house must have cost in the region of £40,000 when it was built about 1890. So Thomas's fortune, made in tea, financed the purchase of the land as well as the design and construction of Falkland Park. A lasting legacy to the power of tea. Unfortunately, Thomas ran into financial difficulties, supposedly due to the delay of his tea clippers laden with tea from his gardens. This was coupled with a slump in the world tea prices at that time. He moved back into Grangehurst and put Falkland Park and its estate up for sale. It was sold to Charles A. Walker in 1898. For some of the time, the McMeekins and the Haywalkers both lived there. The McMeekins in Grangehurst and the Haywalkers in Falkland Park. Thomas later retired to Bournemouth, where some time later he died. Here we are, an unexpected treat, standing on top of Falkland Mansion, built by my great-grandfather Thomas McMeekin, and we are on the very roof and the turret of the tower. So we're looking out over central and south London, and no wonder in the 1890s he built this, because the view is absolutely fantastic. High elevation, can see the whole panoramic view. So I feel I have completed my mission of finding out about Thomas McMeekin's tea times. I have discovered he was an extremely talented, inventive and resourceful character. His dedication to cultivation of tea meant that he faced numerous enormous challenges, which against all odds he managed to overcome. My journey has taken me to meet a whole variety of delightful people, and I'd like to thank everyone who has helped and welcomed our team along the way. It's so marvellous to know the tea estates he founded live on. Finding out about Thomas has helped me discover more about myself, and I certainly understand more about my early morning cup of tea. Most importantly, I now realise Thomas McMeekin wasn't just a great grandfather, but a truly great man.